Board proceedings will now come to order. Would you please punch in if you haven't? And we'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Supervisor Locke with the invocation.
As we gather for this meeting, we call upon our Creator to be with us and to surround us with people who care and inspire us all to make the right decisions. Amen.
Supervisor Roble.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll move for the approval of this evening's agenda.
It's been moved and seconded to approve this evening's agenda. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Is there anybody from the public that would like to speak on anything on the agenda this evening? Now is your chance to talk. So there's two mics in the back, so if somebody from the public has something to speak about, anything that's on the agenda, now is your chance to come up and say something. Okay, that portion of the meeting will be closed. Reports from committees, commissions, and boards. Supervisor Finch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's not really the committee that I'm on, but I want to speak a minute or two about the fair from last month. These people put on a superb fair, and the hours that they put in, we all should be very grateful that we have such dedicated people, not only here on the county board, but in the office, just people in general. I mean, I was so impressed with how they did it and how they kept things moving. I'm going to go one step further. To the fair committee and people that worked it.
Thank you. Supervisor Norton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to point out that this Thursday, September 3rd, at 3:45 in the Coggan Building in the volunteer room, the Parks Committee is going to be taking up an issue of the EA problem and how the Parks Department is addressing it. And I'm addressing this because I was at another committee where another supervisor talked about it and asked me, and then he stated how another supervisor thought that Parks Department wasn't doing anything. So at the next day at our Parks Committee meeting, they brought it up, and it's on our agenda. So I would hope that those supervisors who are concerned about what the Parks Department is doing shows up at 3:45 because it's on our agenda. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other reports? Supervisor Singstad.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to recommend that we recognize and congratulate the Manassas baseball team for their winning the Northeastern Wisconsin Baseball League Championship 3 years in a row. Our fellow supervisor, Thomas Konitsky, is the team vice president and general manager. He has given much time and effort into helping the team to achieve the team's success.
Thank you. Are there any other comments about? Okay, correspondence from the clerk. She has nothing. I would just like to announce Supervisor Widener had asked to be excused, and so did Supervisor Turner, that asked to be excused from this evening's meetings. And I wanted to remind the supervisors that there is iPad training, so whoever has their iPads and would like to know how to use them, contact Patty Fancour, and she'll see that you get trained. But there are different sessions going on. I don't have the dates in front of me, but there are times when you can go to get help to figure out how to use it if you're having a problem. At this time, I would like your approval to appoint to the Land Conservation Committee Supervisor Guy Haig.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All in favor of that appointment, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. And then I have another appointment. Pardon? UW Extension, UW Education and Extension and Agriculture Committee. I'd like to appoint George Shirk to it.
Second.
Then moved and seconded. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. At this time, I would like to introduce Sheriff Motz, and he'll introduce his officers. They're going to give us a demonstration on their canines. You want these lights dimmed down? I guess maybe not.
All right, good evening. This is, everybody hear me? It's always a pleasure to introduce our canines, canine handlers. They are amazing deputies that take a lot of extra time, the handlers, in taking care of our dogs, working with our dogs, and it is not an easy task, not an easy task at all. When they train the 16 hours a month, it is in this kind of weather, it's in absolutely bitter cold, so there are a lot of things that they do to have the privilege of having one of our dogs, and I truly appreciate their effort. I'm going to introduce all of the dogs individually, and I'm going to talk about our canine program. Before I do that, though, I'm sure some of you are wondering about what happened in Brown County with the canine that died in a squad. We have the same kind of system that they have in their car that we have in our car. Theirs failed. What happens is when the temperature in the car reaches a certain amount, the windows come down, a fan goes on, the lights start to blink, the horn makes noise, sirens go off. I mean, you can't miss it. That failed. And it went into a sleep mode. They are checking to see if it's just that individual unit or if there's a problem with the unit itself. Ours are checked previously on a weekly basis. Now they're checked daily to make sure that they're working. We will be going in front of the PNF committee very shortly to add an additional safeguard that will notify three cell phones if the temperature in the car reaches a certain degree, whatever that we decide that to be, 70 degrees or whatever. We will, that software will call the handler phone, it will call our patrol supervisor phone, and we'll call dispatch. So we want to make sure that the investment that we have in these dogs, which is substantial, is safeguarded. So we're taking that extra effort because of how much they mean to the agency and how helpful they are to our community. We have three canine handler teams as supervisors, and all of our teams use the Ford SUV. They're all relatively new vehicles. We rotate them every 3 years, but with a canine vehicle, because it's actually one-on-one to the handler, it'll rotate less often. They are the only one-on-ones that we have within the in the sheriff's office, are those three particular vehicles that go with the patrol deputies because they need to transport the dog. The squad that was used in Brown County was an older Crown Vic, which the air conditioning actually failed, which could have had something to do with the issue. The three dogs that we have were born in Europe, and they were shipped to a kennel in Campbellsport, where we buy all of our dogs. The price of the dogs vary a little bit, but it's between $11,500 and $13,000. It's a lot of money, but with that comes the training of our deputies to acclimate to the dog. The dog already comes partially trained, as I'll get to. They're trained from birth, starting in a patrol capacity between 1 and 3 years of age. The handlers go through a selection process. I'd make the final decision, but certainly the administrative staff will let me know who they suggest, and we will look at what that deputy has done for the agency and whether or not they're fitted to be a handler. And they have to attend a four-week course at the kennel in Campbellsport to acclimate to the dog, and they create that bond. Our canine units are mainly trained for two purposes: narcotics detection and criminal apprehension. Additionally, ours are trained in tracking, handler protection, building an area, and article searches. And we've used them in all of these facets. Now, the dogs that you're going to see tonight are relatively new. Kai, the one that's up front here, is our newest dog, so it doesn't have a lot of experience. And you'll see what he's been responsible for in the short time that he's been with our agency. But we we actually ran into a SWAT incident where we had an individual that was up in an attic. Couldn't get him out. We tried chemical spray. We believed him to be armed with a weapon. We tried putting the dog up on a shield and sending him up there, but the dog wasn't real keen on us holding on to that. Since then, we actually have trained the dogs to trust us enough where we can do that. So next time, if we have that, I don't want to be the guy in the attic when the dog comes. They require regular training. Again, there's 16 hours of formalized training that occurs at the kennel, and each dog must pass a yearly certification. Handlers train daily with their dogs for exposures to new tasks, and they create quite a bond. It'll be very evident tonight. I'll introduce the teams. First is Deputy Erica Geshrai, K-9 Kai. Now, K-9 Kai actually came to us since April of 2015 through a very generous donation of Tom and Penny Herrenberg. Penny is here tonight, and we truly appreciate everything that you've done for our agency. It was a substantial donation, not only for the dog, but for the container unit that's in the rear of the squad. So I'd like to recognize her with a round of applause. They work a day shift together. We now have dogs on coverage on pretty much the entire 24-hour shift. They've been together since April of 2015, and he is the largest, weighing in at 85 pounds. Since May 11th, he has been deployed 29 times. He seized 15.3 grams of THC, which is marijuana, 3 grams of cocaine, 4 pieces of drug paraphernalia, and we seized one vehicle. When we seize vehicles or we seize money, 50% of that money, it takes quite a process to actually get the vehicles or the money actually in our account, because there's a process that we have to go through. But you will see more seizures as we talk about the other dogs. In June of 2015, Deputy Geshrai stopped the vehicle at K-9 Kai alerted on. The vehicle contained bags of THC equaling 15 grams, crack cocaine of 3 grams, and driver arrested for intent to deliver, and the vehicle was seized, which is the one that we just talked about. Kai is probably our calmest of the dogs, which is good. We got to have one that's, you know, relatively calm, and he does a lot of our community events. The kids love him, and the community really appreciates the times that Kai spends with them. Next one is Deputy Kyle Schoonover, K-9 Tim. Tim is a 4.5-year-old shepherd. They've been together since November of 2013. I don't want to dig up bad stuff, but Tim was the one that cost us a little bit of money when he bit the other dog. For those of you that were on the board, those things happen, and it was a handler issue, but Tim has really grown to be quite an asset for us. He weighs in at 75 pounds, and he is assigned a second shift. Since November 1st, they have seized 2.3 grams of THC, 7.2 grams of cocaine, 8.2 grams of heroin, 118 grams of meth, which is making a comeback in our area, and $26,000 in drug-related cash. They frequently assist the MEG unit with recovering narcotics. Some of them will come from UPS products through the U.S. mail. We will meet them there if there's a suspicious package, and we'll help them out with search warrants as well. During a SWAT call, he was assisted to locate violent subject. On January 27th, alerted on a vehicle that contained over six pounds of marijuana, Vicodin tablets, and $8,300. He alerted on a vehicle containing 118 grams of meth and $4,300. The business of drug trafficking is very lucrative.
You said alerted on a vehicle. What does that mean?
You will see with
the officer.
You have to punch in so people can hear you on TV.
You walk around the vehicle, and the dog will alert by scratching or paying an exorbitant amount of attention to a specific area.
So the car's already stopped.
Car's already stopped, yep. Next one is K-9 Franz. He is a 4-year-old German Shepherd, works third shift. They've been together since September of 14, and he's the smallest one, but he's got a little bit of an attitude, which you're going to see. October 14, since then they've been deployed 215 times. 170 grams of THC, 3.8 grams of coke, 1.4 grams of heroin, meth, $475 drug-related cash. He's conducted over 12 tracks and missing persons with three non-bite apprehensions. Attracted male subject wanted for property crimes and heroin possession from the back window of a residence. Located him in a swamp behind the house. Announcements were made and given the suspect was taken in custody without incident. Typically, when we tell them there's a canine on scene, they will just give up because they watch what happens on TV, and I've been bit by dogs before. It's not pleasant. We actually had one of our dogs tracking the OWI suspect, a drunk driving suspect. I ran out of the vehicle, chased him through a cornfield. That suspect actually came back to that squad and jumped in the squad because they were being chased by the canine. That is perfect. In May of 2015, a suspect was wanted for multiple pump crimes, assisted in locating this subject. Announcements were given and the suspect fled through the back where apprehension was made. Some of these do occur with a bite, but that is that announcement is made to them, and that's the risk that they take as a criminal. We do use them in conjunction with our SWAT teams. Our SWAT team is a regional team, so it can be sent to other areas. The equipment that we have is shared by all of the SWAT teams in the 13 county area, but we constantly train with the canines on our SWAT team to get them accustomed to that high energy, high level type of them. Two of the teams, Tim and Franz, are members of the SWAT team. They attended a week-long conference, a week-long school to certify them as SWAT canines, and they're able to assist us in apprehending dangerous subjects. Now, it's sad when we lose a dog. There's no doubt. But when you lose a deputy, when we lose a person, it's obviously much different. So it's not that we would give them up willingly and freely, but certainly if there's a choice to be made, the dog will take the risks and the deputy will not, if that's possible. Those are my two dogs. That's Chumley on the right and Carlos on the left. And I just wanted free lunch. So what we're going to do now is you are going to meet Canine Pop. Deputy Geoffrey will try to put him up on the table, try, so he doesn't slide off. And she can get a good look at him. She'll talk to you a little bit about what it's like to be a handler.
Try.
Too slippery. Yeah.
Slippery. This is Kai. He just turned two about 3 weeks ago. Like the sheriff said, he's the newest canine in our department. He is a dual purpose canine, like we discussed. He does narcotics detection, tracking, building area searches, and handler protection. He's going to protect me. So far, things are going great. We're just both trying to get our feet wet and get experience like the other two handlers. So far, things are going really well. Kai comes home with me every day. He lives with me. This is my family. I have 5-year-old twins at home. He is really well with them, very protective of them, very gentle. So anytime I'm at work, Kai is with me.
If you have any questions individually about a particular dog, please let us know as the dog's coming up, and then at the end we'll answer any questions overall.
There's some materials that Deputy Stunover and canines are going to use this a little bit to show a lot of how to detect, so he can smell that. That's why he's being so antsy up here as well as he's still.
Do you ever have more than one dog at a scene?
They don't get along real well. That's why we don't have them in the same room. Okay. Kai's pretty good with the other dogs. The other two, yeah, they're alpha males, all of them, so that's the only bad part about them as an employee. They don't want overtime. They never file a grievance. They always want to work. They are a perfect employee, but they don't get along well with others.
They
can do something. Okay, what we'll do is we'll bring in Tim.
I need to set up some materials for him first.
Okay.
Can I copy?
So the three handlers, the dogs, one of the questions you might have is how long does a dog last? It's typically about 7 to 8 years, somewhere in that time. Then they'll go 9, depending upon hips. We get them certified not to have a hip problem, but injuries can occur. They can get sick. We recently had one of ours retire, and he passed away about 9 months after he retired. So you got to remember, these are high-energy dogs. It's not like Chum and Carlos, although I hope Carlos is a good pheasant dog. They are constantly going. So they want to work every day, all the time, and that wears on them. So their lifespan, and they're a larger dog. They're a larger breed. So we're going to get about 7 to 8 years out of them. And we have started a canine fund that is quite active. For those of you that have bought some of the toys, the canine toys, we have more on the way. That thing was unbelievable how quickly they're selling them. I think we sold 1,000 already, and we make $6.50 on each of them. We sell them for $15, and then we got another 500 coming, and I think we probably sold about 250 of those just in people emailing us and asking us to hold them. We also are expecting an additional donation that's quite large. What we want to do is have enough money in the account that we can maintain the program. The cost of the taxpayer is very limited, so we can cover out of there. The software that I just spoke about will come out of the canine fund. It won't come out of the tax levy at all. It'll come out of that fund. The replacement of the dog. So after 7 or 8 years, we'll have enough money so we can replace all those dogs and not have to put it into our budget. Is Tim ready?
We're letting the other dog.
We got to let the one.
Okay. Tim is going to do a narcotics. He's going to find narcotics. Larry, here's your opportunity. You said that you might have something in the bag. You got an amnesty box back there? He did say that. But Tim will do a narcotics demonstration of finding it, how he alerts on it. And you'll see that shortly. He gets quite excited.
Yes. Yeah, here you go.
Here you go. The handler will basically search the room. We have no idea where the car, where it might be. And then when the dog gets on an area, it's going to give a lot of attention, scratch, it'll make other things. And Debbie Schooner can explain it as he's doing.
Sure. I'll just go very quickly for the. He's an aggressive indicating dog, which means he's trained to read smells and odor of drugs. Either bite, bark, or scratch. So scratch is his primary way of telling you that he smells drugs. And the barking is more for if something's up high where he can't reach it. As you've seen in many videos, it's very obvious when he smells the drugs. And one of these items we have basically pseudo-cocaine, which is not cocaine, it's just something that has the same odor characteristics as cocaine does. I'll give him a toy. The fighting drugs is a game for him. It's fun for him. So I have to keep it very fun for him. I give him a toy and I'll play with him and stuff. And that's how it keeps him motivated to continue to want to search for drugs.
No, go ahead. Sometimes when we make a traffic stop, the dog gets out. This happens more often than what you think. That's when you just get its infection. Okay, I've got it. It's in my trunk. It's in my wherever. Because the dog is, that's what it's trained to do. Highly successful. We track everything that they do as far as the number of positive hits that they have. You probably see claims once in a while for a scratch on a car, but we may have seized that car or may have lost the seizure for some reason, but there were drugs in that particular car. Are there any questions about the drug detection? Yes.
Did they ever have false hits?
Say it again.
Do they ever
have your mic? Do they ever have false hits?
But I can tell you that sometimes when there's, let's use marijuana. Marijuana has been in the council, and it was just taken out maybe 5 minutes ago. They can still have that odor there.
And is it a false hit? Not necessarily. It was there. It's just gone now. And that's most times what happens. Any other questions?
Supervisor Wennington.
Would you explain the commands? I believe they're not in English. Is that correct?
Right, they're in German.
Almost all the commands are in German.
And if I would accidentally use that word, would they attack me?
I don't think so. I mean, we have such a strong bond with the dogs that they don't generally listen to other people as well as they'll listen to their handler.
Okay. Thank you. The next one we're going to bring in is Franz. Franz is going to do a bite demonstration. Lieutenant Kroenke has voluntold. I'm to wear the bite sleeve. We were going to use Tim for this, the one you just saw, but he has a problem letting go, so we figured. So Franz has been with the agency the longest, and he is trained in bite and hold. And you will see the handler give a command, and the dog is trained to bite in a specific area. But in a dynamic situation, when we're arresting somebody, things are flying all over the place. It's not like classroom model. So sometimes we get a leg, sometimes we get the side. So there are, you know, other areas that are bit, but it's because of the movement of the person, not because of the targeting of the dog. And anytime the dog does something wrong, it's not his fault, it's the handler's fault, and they know that. I don't remember the bite pressure. It's a lot, yeah. I only did this once when Mike was sheriff, and I think I was a lieutenant. I got somehow talked into it. I thought my shoulder was going to get ripped out. It was ice. It was a really large dog. And he did not want to let go, and that's the last time I did it. I don't want anything to do with it.
like you were saying, the normal human bites about 80 pounds of pressure, and a German Shepherd is about 240. About three times as strong as like my annual bite. So with the bite part here, you can see when Kyle was in here, he's in the play drive. You know, he's talking about how he needed to be a game. This is the prey drive. This is when we try to take their natural instincts and use it to our advantage. So you're going to see a completely different drive here once he gets his eyes on Lieutenant Kroenke and hopefully not Sheriff Mons. So, we give announcements because we're not just going to send the dog. We give him the opportunity to surrender. Actually, we give him a lot of opportunities to surrender. So I have to get 3 announcements before I send him. And on the final one, I give him a final warning. And I have the dog, and I'll actually let the dog bark just to show that I'm not bluffing. So you're going to see him when he comes out and he sees Lieutenant Kroenke here, he's going to change his demeanor completely. So, and we'll show you what a bite looks like. Sheriff's Puppets, over your hands. Sheriff's Puppets, over your hands. Final warning, don't surrender. We'll set the dog, we'll be bit.
Most times when people see the dog and they're going through the surrender ritual, they give up because that hurts. That there's no doubt. And unless they're extremely high or intoxicated, typically we get compliance just by having the dog there, by mere presence. And that's the win-win where nobody gets hurt, our dog doesn't have to bite anybody, and everybody goes home safe except for the bad guy going to jail. So.
Does that dog like Kroenke after the fact? I mean,
without that armband on, is he okay with you?
Yeah.
Yeah?
also why I'm not worried.
Okay, let's see now. Okay.
Oh boy.
Wow.
He's constantly looking for other people.
Franz is extremely, and I want to say aggressive, but he is constantly wanting to go. And Deputy Zill is one of our most aggressive officers on third shift, so it carries over into the dog. And aggressive, I mean, he's out there making a lot of traffic stops. He's out there making a difference, and that bleeds over into the dog. But it's all a very controlled environment. Are there any questions about the fund? Or any? Yes.
Once the dog retires after that 7 or 8 years, what happens to him?
We sell the dog to the handler for a dollar. We have talked about selling the dog to other people, but there's a liability that goes with it, and it's not fair to the dog, and it's not fair to the handler. That bond that they have is amazing. It is that is your partner that you are with, you know, 240 days a year when they're on active patrol and in some very, very stressful situations. So we sell it to them for a dollar, and then they take care of all the medical costs. We're not responsible for anything other than just collecting the dollar.
Supervisor Norton.
Thank you. Sheriff, what kind of surprised me about the Brown County situation was a Brown County unit in an event that was in Sheboygan County. My question to you is, what is your criteria for sending out a unit to a specific event in the county or outside the county?
Well, that was a bomb sniffing dog, which we don't have. We allow our dogs, if we have a mutual aid request, you know, we'll allow our dogs to go on a search for a fugitive, whatever it might be. But again, our handlers are responsible for those dogs, and they take it very, very serious. Although I can't guarantee you that nothing bad's going to happen, I mean, we have gone to great lengths to make sure that the dogs are taken care of. In answer to your question, yes, we do loan them out, so to speak. Sometimes it's paid. Sometimes if it's, you know, something where it's immediate, we'll just send them out to whatever, a neighboring county if need be, for short periods of time. Yes?
So, a number of years ago, I used to work with the police department in Menasha, an office, not as an officer. And we did have a dog, a trained dog at the time. That's many years ago already, but that was when this first came about. But I was amazed. We had the dog. I don't know if any of you are at all familiar with what our old police station was like, with up on the top of a bank building in the inside. I mean, it was not obviously not a police station. But the handler hid a package of marijuana in upstairs where a bar was in this particular building, and the doors were opened, and they put the marijuana in the inside. And then the dog was on the first floor. The dog knew nothing about this, I assume. And then they left the dog loose. The handler took him up. And that dog walked into there, and it was like it was a one straight shot right to where this cupboard was underneath the bar. And here he had the marijuana. And I always wonder, are they trained awful lot on the smell of marijuana or the whatever it was? Because he took one straight shot, and it was like he flew up the steps. And
yeah, they are amazing. Their sense of smell is how many times greater than a human?
A lot of numbers out there, but they think around 10,000.
Oh, I believe that. And the dog was like he was shot out of a gun. I mean, that was just up those steps and in there, and he immediately knew where it was.
Yep. And that's what they love to do. So, I mean, that's their, you know, that's their passion. So they are very good at it, very skilled.
Supervisor Haig.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Was there just a court ruling about how long you can detain somebody in a traffic violation to have a dog search?
It can be no longer than what the traffic stop would have otherwise been. So if I make a traffic stop and Deputy Zill is behind me while I'm writing that citation or while I'm writing that warning, having conversation with the driver, he can go around the vehicle. It can't be any longer than what the actual stop would be. So in an average stop taking about 10 minutes. So the stop can't go longer than 10 minutes. We can't wait for him to come there.
So basically we have 3 canines now. How does that compare to other counties that are roughly our size?
Well, I don't know what Brown County has out of Gamey County. I'm not sure. I know they've got a bomb sniffing dog for the airport. They do have some patrol dogs, you know?
Out of Gamey has 6 police canines, and now Brown County has 5.
In regards to the, off topic a little bit, in regards to the tragic happenings the last couple few days, have you been encouraging your staff to participate in any additional security wherever they're about?
Yeah. We have received alerts about the law enforcement being attacked on off duty. There are alerts that are out there. A lot of this is lone wolf stuff. Some of it is, and I won't say it's terrorist related, but it's related to what's occurring right now in our country. So they are taking extra efforts. A lot of them don't wear a uniform to work anymore. They're taking different routes to work. They don't stop at a convenience store on the way to work where they would have in the past if they're in a uniform. There are a lot of things that are really scary for law enforcement right now, and it's not just the possibility of being attacked, of being assassinated. It's also being assassinated in public opinion before anything even gets out, before the truth is even known. And so it's we're having a difficult time actually recruiting people because of that. You know, when you look at, and I'm not complaining about anything about the job, but when you look at what they make and the risks that they take and now all of the other things, you know, I can make that money other places.
And lastly, how'd you go about naming a German dog Carlos?
Yeah, you know, I don't know. My son and I, you have to blame him. We were eating dinner one night. We decided on Carlos. He got Carl, which is actually a German name. I kind of shortened it up.
Supervisor Sinkstuck.
Yeah. In a very rare situation, would one dog handler be able to fill in with another dog's, for another dog's handler with that dog, with that handler's dog?
Not without training. We have changed handlers midstream. We had a dog, we had a patrol deputy that went to a detective division. We brought in a different patrol deputy. She spent 4 weeks with that dog and acclimated to the dog, and there was a new handler. That you can do, but to just take a handler and take Bob and put him with Kai probably wouldn't work. They get to know the voice inflection. That is the master. So there has to be that deprogramming that occurs first.
Supervisor Egan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have no question, but I have a compliment to Sheriff Motz and his handlers and the dogs. This year at the fair, Erica and Kai was at the fair, and they put on demonstrations for one whole day. And, well, one time Kai even fell off the stage, but besides that, they had to attack and everything else 2-3 times. And after it was over with, they sat right there, and they let a line of kids go right through, pet them. Elderly in wheelchairs come up, and that dog never moved a bit. And I think that's a big accomplishment to let know that what we have confide in these animals, and that the handlers can also have that much confidence, because they could have just well turned the other way. So I congratulate you.
You're welcome.
Supervisor Warnke.
Do you confiscate vehicles when you find drugs in them? And what happens to them? And what happens to the cash that you confiscate?
We do. It takes a fair amount of time to get that through the court process. It is a 50-50. What we do then with the vehicle is we'll sell it at a sheriff's auction, and you'll see it listed various times on our website. We're selling a boat that we confiscated. There's a camper trailer. There'll be things that come up occasionally. Then we take that and split it 50-50 with the school district. So the schools get 50% and we get 50%, and that's by law. If it's seized federally, it's a little bit different. It's 70-30. But we typically don't do that because we don't get too involved in federal investigations, although it has occurred.
So you're saying that money goes into the sheriff's department then? You're 50?
It goes into our canine fund. Well, actually, it goes back into our buy fund for our undercover work. And it's not as substantial as what you might think because of the type of vehicles that these individuals drive. They're not that hot. We might get $700-$800 for a vehicle because they know that there's a possibility of it being confiscated, and many of them rent vehicles, and we can't confiscate a rented vehicle.
Okay. Thank you. Supervisor Olson.
Thank you. I don't want to drag this on too long, but I just have
couple of questions about the whole process. Before the dog can actually go into the car or smell the trunk and everything, do you need a search warrant?
No.
You don't?
No.
Okay, I was wondering about that because I've seen a couple of them in front of my house. And
yeah, they can go around the car.
Well, this officer had the dog actually go inside the car.
Once there's an alert on the vehicle, then they can enter it.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
That's it.
Thank you.
Recognition of the 2015 4-H Key Award recipients. I'd like them to come forward. Madeline Egan, Hannah Krieger, and Wanda Kundi. And Sarah Thompson from the UW Extension. She's the 4-H Youth Science Educator. I'd like her to come forward and present the awards.
Good evening. My name is Sarah Thompson. I am the 4-H Youth and Science Educator with Winnebago County UW Extension. And before we get started, I'd like to introduce to you our new 4-H Youth Educator, Kayla Oberstadt, who just started in our office at the beginning of August. But we are here to recognize three young ladies, two of them are here tonight, who have been awarded the 4-H Key Award, which is the highest award a 4-H member can receive. The commendation that they will be receiving actually states this: whereas she has received the highest award in 4-H youth development, that being the Wisconsin Key Award, and whereas the 4-H youth development program promotes the ideals of character, conduct, patriotism, and service, encouraging members to become productive and contributing citizens, and whereas she as a 4-H member represents our country's greatest resource, that being our youth, and whereas she continues the legacy of 4-H youth development in the United States and serves as a role model for young 4-H members, and whereas she serves as an inspiration to all of us, demonstrating that hard work and perseverance can make dreams come true. Now therefore, be it hereby resolved that Wisconsin 4-H Key Award recipient, whatever, be commended for her achievement of 4-H youth development's highest award. And these are signed by both David Albrecht and Susan Ertmer. First, I would like to introduce Madeline Egan. And Kayla, if you'd like to stand there. Maddie is a member of Newcomers 4-H Club. She has served her club as reporter, secretary, treasurer, and most recently as president. She attended Badger Dairy Camp, 4-H Teen Winter Camp, and Wisconsin 4-H and Youth Conference. She has also improved her leadership skills by attending 4-H Leaders Around the Lake, 4-H Winter Leadership Camp, and has served as a counselor for Cloverbud Camp and 4-H Summer Camp. Maddie has also served her community by volunteering with the elderly, ringing bells for the Salvation Army, and serving food at the Dairy Breakfast on the Farm, to name some of them. Some of her 4-H projects include dairy, swine, music, cultural arts, photography, foods, and youth leadership, of which she has received merit awards and has state fair recognition. It is my pleasure to recognize Madeline Egan. Next, I would like to introduce Hannah Krieger. Hannah is a member of Westward 4-H Club, where she has been a member for 10 years. She has served as president and secretary and also as the treasurer of the Winnebago County Horse and Pony Project. Hannah is a member of the 4-H Ambassadors, has attended Wisconsin 4-H and Youth Conference, the 4-H American Spirit Experience, and most recently was selected to attend the 2015 Citizen Washington Focus Trip. Hannah has participated in numerous activities with the Horse and Pony Project at the club, county, district, state, and national levels. In addition to horses, Hannah has also shown projects such as sewing, cultural arts, and youth leadership at the county fair and at the state fair. Hannah, too, has served as a counselor at 4-H camp and has volunteered at nursing homes and has worked with county fundraisers. Congratulations, Hannah. And Wanda Cundy is unable to be with us this evening. She is at work tonight. She is a member of Westward 4-H Club, where she started as a clover bud when she was in kindergarten. Wanda has been very active with the dairy and swine projects. She received the James W. Crowley Dairy Award last year and was placed in the top 10 in the state of applicants. She earned the Wisconsin Pork Association Scholarship this year for her outstanding swine membership and her leadership skills. Wanda has served as a 4-H Clover Bud Counselor, as a 4-H Ambassador, has worked as a pizza maker for our countywide fundraisers, and has participated in county bowling and skating events. Her other 4-H projects include photography, flowers and houseplants, foods and nutrition, vegetables, animal science, home environment, cultural arts, and youth leadership. And we will get this award to Wanda. These young ladies all represent Winnebago County 4-H very well, and we are very pleased and to have them here with us tonight, and they are very deserving of this award. Thank you so much.
Scott Jensen from the Appleton Ice had called and had something else came up where he couldn't make that presentation tonight, but he will be making a presentation in the next month or so. So he'll be coming back to us on the Appleton Ice Arena. At this time, Tom Egan's going to update us on his county fair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll give you a brief update. All the bills and that are still coming in, including the parks and the sheriff's department, which is usually large, so I can't give you any money figures yet this year. But it was a real successful fair this year. Other than Friday, we did get rained out completely. The carnival never turned a wheel or anything, so the only thing that went on was the band, and that had about 20 people in, and in one of the other bars down by where the barn people were. They were very happy to see all the rain come down, but otherwise it was very successful. Carnival said that we're up every night, and so we can't say enough. One of the things I do want to say is thank you to all you director supervisors that did come, just come to observe, and also those of you that judged. It's an honor, as you've seen them two girls that were just up here. Them are the kind of people that we're there for. There's 19 of us that are elected, and one that's off from the Nancy's off the Ag and Extension Committee representing them. So there's 20 of us on there, and some of us have, I don't, but some have grandchildren. Otherwise, there's very few with any children on there. It's mainly those of us that are on there for the young people like that. We do have elections coming up in December. There are 7 openings. If anyone is interested in getting in or you know of somebody, we'd surely like to have you. The final thing, unless there's any questions, I do want to say is now that we have the iPads and a lot of you are already on it, and hopefully all of us get on them sooner or later, but instead of handing out all the paper material at the end of the year, possibly maybe we'll just have our year end, we'll have all put right on there so we don't have to go ahead and pay for all of that. Is that right, Madam Treasurer? That would be real nice. Julie's our treasurer, and she does a great job. I got to give her a lot of compliment on that. So that's our plans right now. We'll make off enough copies maybe for the chairman and also for the Ag and Extension Committee, and the rest we'll have right on there. And those of you that would like to look at it is more than welcome to. But again, we want to thank all of you, and we'll give you an update as time comes on. But right now, we're still paying bills. Thank you.
Thank you. John Raby, the director of the Solid Waste Department, is going to give us an update on his Solid Waste Department. Well, first I have to compliment you because 90% of the people come can't make it work.
So, lucked out tonight. Yes, welcome. My name is John Raby. I'm the Solid Waste Director for Winnebago County, obviously, here to give a report on the department. I've got two people with me tonight, Kurt Permsteiner, who is the Facility Manager, and Jennifer Summerall, who is the Recycling Coordinator. They both assist with operations of our department, but also helped up put the PowerPoint together tonight. So we'll walk you through this. If you'd like a hard copy of the handouts, I can give that to you afterwards. If you'd like this emailed to you, We can do that as well after the meeting, so. Oh, yes. First off, just a little introduction on the department. The Solid Waste Management Board was created in 1975 by the Winnebago County Board to provide solid waste management services to communities, businesses, and industry in Winnebago County. We currently operate under Chapter 15 of the Winnebago County General Code, and we strive to provide quality integrated solid waste management services for our users while remaining cost conscious and environmentally responsible. And a fact of note is our operations of the department are fully funded by user fees, tipping fees, so we're not on the tax levy. Just a little background. Back in 2002, we joined forces with Outagamie County and Brown County, pooling our solid waste and recycling resources and to create more efficiency for these services within the three-county region. First off, we signed a solid waste agreement that the term is roughly 25 years. It went into effect in January of 2003, and it goes through 2027 or later, depending on the airspace usage. And essentially what we do is we all had about the same amount of landfill airspace, so we pooled the resources and we use one site. Our site was one of the first ones to be used and closed. It's now at Outagamie County, and then we'll follow up at Brown County at a later date. We also entered into a recycling agreement, which the initial term was 15 years, and in 2009, when we constructed the Tri-County Single Stream Facility at Outagamie County, we tacked on another 15 years to that document. So that runs through 2024 currently. One of the key topics that the three counties are talking about, other than day-to-day operations, we're looking at a point next year where we have to decide on the solid waste agreement if we're going to just let the first term run its course or if we're going to sign on for another term. So we've been having some meetings talking about that document, so future landfill airspace planning has been a topic of discussion lately with three counties. So a little bit about the department. Our table of organization includes 16 full-time employees, and before we started the regional agreement, we were at 28 employees. We have an approximately $10 million operational budget. The DNR requires us to set aside dollars for taking care of these landfills long-term and also for the closure of the sites. So we have about $15 million set aside in DNR required escrow accounts. We also have set aside roughly $25 million in a retained earnings reservation, which we review the allocation for these emergency type funds and adjust amounts accordingly depending on the department's performance. And a fact of note is the 2015 standard tipping fee for solid waste at our facility is $40 a ton. That compares to a statewide average of greater than $59 a ton based on DNR compiled information. So that just plays to the efficiencies that our three county group has provided for our users. Okay, just to go through a few of the different areas that we deal with, solid waste. We were the regional solid waste landfill from 2005 until the middle of 2012. The Sunnyview landfill was closed and capped in 2013. The top photo shows an aerial view that was flown last November, showing the closed larger co-disposal portion of the landfill on your right and a smaller industrial waste landfill sludge site on the left. So since the landfill closed, we still continue to handle waste and recyclables from our users. So we operate a transfer station now. So all the solid waste that comes into our facility is scaled in and then is unloaded in a transfer station, which is an enclosed building. From there, it is loaded into semi-transfer trailers using front-end loaders, and we have a subcontracted hauler that transports that material daily up to Outagamie County. Anywhere from 15 to 25 loads per day go out of that facility and up to Outagamie County. We're looking at ways to reduce transportation costs. So one of the things we're looking at designing is a waste compactor that would allow us to increase payloads on the semi itself. Right now we're averaging roughly 20 tons per load of solid waste in a semi-trailer. With a compactor, we could get upwards of 30 tons per load and save overall transportation costs. And again, like I mentioned, Outagamie County is currently the regional landfill. Initially, the term, they were thinking around 8 years, but based on waste tonnages and some of the densities that they're getting, they're looking at somewhere around year 2022 as when we'd have to make the switch to Brown County. In addition to the trees, in addition to the transfer station, we still have that smaller industrial landfill that has airspace remaining. It's not part of the Tri-County group, so we've started taking paper mill sludge, coal ash, and foundry sand materials from customers to use up that airspace. So we take in anywhere from 5 to 10 loads of those materials a day in the sludge site. One of the newer things that we've really been looking at is diversion of waste materials, trying to pull out materials in addition to banned DNR items that can be recycled. And some of those are construction and demolition waste, or C&D waste, asphalt shingles, and yard waste. So we've started to ramp up programs for those, and I'll have some tonnage information to show you in a later slide. And one of our board members, our solid waste board members, was asking, you know, how big the landfill footprint at Outagamie is to handle the 10 years of disposal from the three-county group. And their northeast landfill is roughly 53.2 acres. That's the footprint. And that will handle roughly 10 years of disposal capacity, and we're running about 600,000 tons per year of waste into that facility. Yeah, shifting over to recycling. On the recycling front, when we built the Tri-County single stream facility at Outagamie County, the other two counties, Brown and Winnebago, run transfer stations now. So we collect recyclables that are municipally and privately collected, and again we unload them in a closed building, and then we load them into semis, and they're shipped up to Outagamie County, again using Crowd Camp Trucking, where they are processed. We're doing the same, we're looking at doing the same with the recyclables, putting in a compactor. Instead of getting 11, 12 tons per load, we'd look to bump that up to around 22 or 23 tons per load, something that wouldn't compact the materials too much where they'd be tough to process, but get it to a density that's typical from a route municipally collected vehicle. So again, the Tri-County Recycling Facility in Outagamie County provides the single stream processing services for our three counties, as well as additional private recyclables from further outreaching than just the three counties. And what we've done recently is added a second shift for processing recyclables, and we've been running that for two years roughly. So we run two full 8-hour shifts at the facility, a first and second shift, and then do maintenance on the third shift. We've also finished the installation of a second baler line to allow a little more flexibility instead of just one baler for all the commodities. We have two different balers, allows us to be a little more efficient. We've also upgraded some of the sorting stations to allow all plastic containers instead of ones and twos. Now we are opening it up to all plastic containers, as well as aseptic cartons, your orange juice cartons, or your school type milk containers. And the Tri-County facility, when we initially started, we were running one shift with a little overtime, roughly 50,000 tons per year. That was pretty much the majority of the tonnage came from within the three counties. But since then, since we built it, the materials have continued to come into the site, and we were at over 97,900 tons in 2014. We're running at a pace similar to that, maybe a little behind in 2015, but still a strong facility. I guess what I tried to do here is summarize some tonnages for you and identify different materials, where they're going. I've got 2014 complete year tons, and I've got a little bit of a comparison with what we're seeing thus far 6 months into 2015. So again, solid waste that's being transferred to Outagamie County. We ran 82,907 tons through our transfer station in 2014, supplemented with direct hauls. We have some different customers that it's more efficient for them to just go direct to Outagamie County, and we try to offer that service if we can. So 36,761 direct hauls. And if you look at where we're at 2015, 6 months into the year, on the transfer station side, we're a little bit behind, 36,735. Same goes for direct hauls, 17,020. But in the general ballpark of where we'd like to be. The next item is our industrial waste disposal, our sludge site, taking in paper mill sludge, coal ash, and foundry sand. 2014, the total tons, 25,184. And as you can see, this year, year to date, we're at 15,310. That's through June. We've actually taken on some additional ash, fly ash from the Weston 4 power plant to assist with operations, providing some additional stability, beneficially reusing that material. So we'll see numbers probably in the 30 to 35,000 ton per year range when we're all said and done with 2015. On the recycling side of things, transfer station, these stay relatively consistent. Transfer station in 2014, 11,437. We're at 5532 6 months into the year. So we're looking to track right on with 2014. The direct hauls, 2561 in 2014, and again, we're roughly right in that ballpark 6 months into the year. And just to highlight some of the other recyclable materials that we're diverting from landfill disposal, the mixed C&D waste, asphalt shingles, and then our grass leaves and yard waste. In 2014, our C&D waste, we had shipped 2,584 tons to a facility in Appleton that processes those, pulls out what they can recycle, and then the rest is landfilled. And thus far in 2015, we've already sent 2,873 tons up there. So we're on pace to double that output in 2015. Asphalt shingles, a little different story, 2,130 tons in 2014. And for whatever reason, people not re-roofing, storms, that sort of thing, 6 months year to date, we've only done 655 tons. And then on the grass leaves and yard waste program, just started working with UW Oshkosh and their biodigester, trying to provide them with some additional feedstock to operate that unit efficiently. So in 2014, we sent them 72 tons of basically just grass clippings that we had segregated. that they used as a food stock for that facility. But in 2015, we continued discussions. We looked at some other materials, how we might be able to grind some other materials, segregate things better, provide them with a little more feedstock. And 6 months into the year, we've sent about 700 tons to the facility. They're requesting roughly 40 to 50 tons per week if we can provide it. So it's a real good partnership with UW Oshkosh. So one of the byproducts of solid waste decomposition is landfill gas. And the DNR requires us to collect and combust that that product from both the Snell Road and Sunnyview landfills. We have an older Snell Road site that was closed back in the late 80s, and so we're required to collect that gas and destroy it in some way, shape, or form to maintain our air permit compliance. So the Snell Road site is a 20-plus-year-old site. It's not really producing a whole lot of good quality gas. So we just operate a flare, a small flare system for that gas. However, the newer site, the Sunnyview site, there's definitely more gas being produced there. So what the Solid Waste Board has done is ramped up installing five basically engines that run on landfill gas and are hooked to a generator, generate electricity, and send the power to the grid where we're paid for green credits and the power we generate. We do have a flare system in case the engines were to go down, the compressor system would go down. We have to be able to collect the gas and destroy it, so there's a flare at the Sunnyview site as well. We're also tied into the highway department, where they take a small amount of gas, use it in their boilers. They have these dual fuel boilers to reduce heating costs at that facility. And then also at the sheriff's department, two of the engines, engines 4 and 5, were installed there and are now connected to the heating and cooling systems of the facility. So they not only use that for hot water, but to augment the boilers in the winter months. And they also have an absorption chiller that takes that heat, turns it into cooling to help with electric costs in the summer months. Now, when I came here a year and a half ago to talk about the department, the site was more recently closed, and our landfill gas flows from the Sunnyview site were somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,300 to 2,500 CFM. That's cubic feet per minute of gas. That's a lot of gas. The five engine generators use roughly 1,800 when they're running at full load. And then the excess over the years has been burned in a flare, which in the past you may have seen the flare operating more regularly. But where we're at now, 2 years after closing the site and putting the plastic cover on it, is our landfill gas flows have dropped off significantly. So we're in the neighborhood of 1,600 to 1,900, depending on the weather and whatnot. So we're able to run five engines some of the time, but not all the time. And when you shut down one of the engines, it's roughly 350 to 400 feet of gas. So we're having to run the flare periodically. We'll turn on five engines. We'll turn one engine off, and then we'll run the flare to burn off the excess, because the site essentially produces the gas every day, 24/7. You can't let it build up too much or you have odor problems. So unfortunately, we're in that little bit of a game. So we've installed, this summer, we installed 18 replacement gas wells, as well as some leachate injection wells. And our goal is to try to improve the collection of gas from the site to maximize the operation of those five engines. We have a nice power purchase agreement with WPS, and that runs through 2022. So we have a window of time where if we can maximize the use of those engines, we'll benefit our department operations, keeping our tipping fees low. And just a general reference fact here, the power that we generate from the site is roughly the equivalent to 3,000 residential homes.
And what does that equate to in dollars?
Roughly $2.8 million is what we were at in 2014, and that's what we're looking at in 2015 as well. And I guess a slide on some other services we provide. You know, once you finish filling a landfill and close it and cap it, you can't just walk away from it. There's a multitude of closed site monitoring and maintenance and long-term care items that you have to take care of, relating to the air permit, the landfill gas, groundwater and surface water monitoring, leachate monitoring, leachate pumping, maintenance of those systems, paying for disposal, and maintaining the final cover vegetation and surface water drainage systems. In addition, we run a household hazardous material facility. We have a it's a permanent facility, but it's not year-round. That's on the south side of the transfer station. And we also coordinate work with other counties to run clean sweeps, both residential and agricultural clean sweep events. At the landfill itself, you can also, we have opportunities to bring in different DNR banned items, tires, batteries, appliances, computers and electronics, bulbs, used oil filters, used antifreeze, scrap metal, and yard waste. We also provide support to our municipalities that have set up drug drop boxes. I think there's four of them in the county now, set up at police stations. We run our container rental and lease program, offering four different size containers for short-term rentals. We're also looking at taking another look at end use of the sites, both the Snell Road site and the Sunnyview site. In fact, our board is going to be talking about that tomorrow at 9 o'clock. We also have website, newsletters. We hold annual meetings with our tri-county group. We work together with Brown and Outagamie as well at different educational booths, and we created a Facebook page about a year and a half ago. That's a good method of dispersing information to our customers. I guess the last slide is just my contact information, and I guess one other person I'd like to mention that really helped spruce this PowerPoint up is Kathy Hutter, who's our confidential secretary. She sits in on all the board meetings and is very well versed at putting together PowerPoint presentations, so she wasn't here tonight, but she really helped out a lot in putting this together for you. So I guess with that, if you have any questions, I'll try to answer them the best I can.
No, we enjoy hearing about the extra dollars that you help make the executive say that his tax levy is way down because of such and such, you know, so.
Okay, Supervisor Haig.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In regards to the meeting that Mr. Norton mentioned earlier, Park Department is trying to coordinate efforts for Emerald Ash Borer with facilities and UW Extension Agriculture. And I guess I'm entirely remiss not to offer or extend a hand to somebody from Solid Waste as well, because we're going to have to figure out what we're going to do with these trees. So
sure.
If somebody from your department wants to come or could be maybe assigned or volunteer
sure.
to come, that would be great. So
yep.
We could try to coordinate more of a united front when it comes to Emerald Ash Borer and what we're going to do with that. So if you have any ideas, certainly appreciate it.
Okay,
thank you.
Thanks, Guy.
That's it. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much.
At this time, I'd like to ask Doug Guerin to come up. He's going to give us a report on the Level 3 health departments.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a presentation by the State Department of Health Services, and so with us tonight is Chris Collada from the Northeastern Regional Office in Green Bay.
Thank you. As Doug said, my name is Chris Collada. I'm with the Division of Public Health. I'm the Northeast Region Director in Green Bay. So what does that mean? It's a 17-county area. There's 19 local health departments, and there's three tribes. And why am I here? In state statute and in administrative rule, it says every 5 years, the state has to go out and do a minimum compliance check or an audit of all local health departments. And why do we do that? We do that to ensure that all public health departments across Wisconsin are adequately serving their citizens. So what we did in this process is Doug and his staff put together some information on a computer program called SharePoint. And so they did two things. One was level one information. So a level one health department, there's three levels of health department in Wisconsin. A level one is a basic level health department. A level two doesn't mean it's better than level one. It means they offer seven programs or services. And a level three, which Winnebago County is, offers 14 programs and services. And the programs and services, it's not just any program that a health department wants to pick because it's fun. It has to be tied into our state health plan, Healthiest Wisconsin 2020. So we came down on July 10th, my team, and we met with Doug's staff. On site, we spent about 3 hours, and we asked them all kinds of fun questions. What's your policies and procedures? What's your coalition work? Talk to us about how do you interact with the public? I mean, so there's a lot of things that we had a conversation, and the Winnebago County Health Department is doing a fabulous job. So the good news is we don't have to come out for 5 more years. But I think what we found and what we heard is things that we already knew, but at the same time, I think there's a few benefits of having the review. One was, it's an opportunity for me and my staff to interact with the Winnebago County Health Department. I think it was also powerful. There was a number of Board of Health members that attended, and the county executive also made time to attend a good majority. That's powerful. It shows that there's support. And that's where we see where Winnebago County is as a health department. It's because of the support and leadership of Doug, the dedication of his staff, but also the elected officials and the Board of Health. So that's all positive things. And so what I have tonight is a certificate, and it's from our state health officer, Karen McEwen, and it says Certificate of Designation to Winnebago County Health Department. It is a local health department in good standing with the statute set forth by the Wisconsin Legislature and relevant administrative rules. This was signed on July 15, 2015, that Winnebago County will be a level three health department for 5 more years. So this is good news, this is a positive, and really it means that the Winnebago County Health Department is a high performing health department and they're doing a good job meeting the needs of the citizens of Winnebago County.
Thank you, Chris. I do just want to take a moment to thank the Board of Health members and the County Executive for attending, and in particular our staff for the amount of work they put in. This occurs once every 5 years. It's a substantial amount of work to prepare for a review like this, and there's quite a few follow-up questions that occur after we present our information in advance of the site visit. And the staff were pretty remarkable in assembling data and in answering the questions that the state was looking for. So I just want to thank everyone involved.
Okay, are you going to do your organization update?
Yep. And so moving on, thanks again, Chris. I put a handout on your desks right before the meeting started. It's entitled the Winnebago County Health Department Consolidation Update, September 2015. And you may recall several months back, I gave you an update on the consolidation of the North End offices in Neenah. We had two offices in Neenah, at Neenah City Hall and at Neenah Human Services. We're now in one office. But this was just an opportunity to take you back in time a little bit and review the entire consolidation process. Some of you weren't on the board when this process started. It's been a very time-consuming event, and so I just wanted to take a few moments to walk you through where we're at now, you know, since the three-department consolidation occurred, you know, in 2012. So this really goes all the way back to 2010, when we had some discussions with the city of Oshkosh about consolidating. We went as far as drafting a consolidation agreement, and we're moving along on that track when we had a retirement in the Nina Health Department. The health officer there, Judy Smolarek, and that brought to the table perhaps, well, maybe we should discuss looking at this, you know, at a larger level, and so the discussions began with Nina and with Menasha. At that time, we put the Oshkosh potential consolidation on hold to take a look at a larger potential merger. At that time, we moved the work of writing a consolidation agreement and coming up with that agreement from in-house to a consultant. Once we had four departments involved, it was agreed that we wanted to have an outside entity take a look at this. The four departments worked together to draft an RFP. We received several proposals, worked through those proposals, and ultimately selected Baker Tilly as the consultant to actually do the study for the consolidation. There were no assumptions at that point. It was really to take a look at, you know, what are the possible combinations? Is this feasible? Is there going to be a benefit? Is there political will to really make this happen? And so the county, Dave Albrecht, you know, had funds available to get that process started. It was about $50,000 to hire the consultants initially. It became a fairly complex project and ultimately required additional funds, which all the departments that were participating in helped pay for. Ultimately, during that process, the city of Menasha left the process, but we continued on with the consultants looking at an Oshkosh-Nina-Winnebago County merger. That study was very time-intensive, and it took all of 2011, essentially, to gather all of the data, have the meetings with the various entities, develop a final report, develop a consolidation agreement. That consolidation agreement was ultimately proposed to the three jurisdictions and signed in 2012, early in 2012, and we ultimately had a merger with the county and the city of Oshkosh in May of 2012, and additionally with Nina in July of 2012. The departments throughout this process, this, you know, 2+ year process, maintained any vacancies that occurred during that time period. It was important during that process that we recognized that this was a difficult time for staff. It was a period of transition. We wanted to certainly have the staff have as much sense of job security as possible. And the agreement included bringing all of the staff that remained from those three departments together into a new department, all positions that were currently filled were still maintained. The vacancies, and so we were certainly operating at a deficit as individual departments during that time period, and as you can see from the handout, we had about a 21% reduction in staff from three fully staffed departments at the time of consolidation. That certainly helped. That was helped by, you know, efficiencies that were gained by working together, eliminating redundancy in many of our programs. But it also left us, you know, in a position where you know, we had some gaps, you know, in the department. We were overstaffed in some areas, like supporting staffing, but we were understaffed in some areas that we didn't have any capacity left for. And so that process of really coming together as a new department and over time addressing those gaps, retaining all of the staff, but through attrition and through new grant funding or other funding sources, you know, to slowly fill those gaps, you know, without, you know, an excess of costs. So, I mean, the, you know, the 2012, second half of 2012, certainly all of 2013, were, you know, it's rebuilding time, and we've done quite a bit of that. Our first order of business as a new department was to develop a new strategic plan, really try to give a sense of new direction and purpose to all of the staff and start working together as one unit. And as you can imagine, that, you know, that takes a lot of time. There's a lot of changes that occur in a situation like this from where you work and what you do, and the stress of really not necessarily, you know, knowing how things are all going to work out. Into 2014, so, you know, over the course of a couple of years now, we've had some turnover, we've had, like I said, some funding changes, and we've been able to start filling those gaps with some new positions, repurposing some staff into different types of work, so that we could retain them as employees in public health. In 2014, we really wanted to fill some of those gaps, and we had some challenges in 2014. We had quite a bit of funding, around $400,000 worth of funding of our grant funding really came into question. And as you can see, you know, the Wisconsin Well Woman Program, which is that WWWP piece, there was a complete restructuring of that program. We had two full-time staff. We weren't really sure what the outcome of that process would be. We lost one of the staff along the way just because of the uncertainty of what was going to happen. Ultimately, we went from an agency that served women in the Wisconsin Wellman Program for four counties to taking over the services for nine counties and transitioned one of our other staff, and we're actually in the process of that now, to working with the Wisconsin Well-Woman Program where we needed that additional capacity. We had a community transformation grant, which we've spoken about in the past. That grant was cut 2 years short by the CDC. Federal reallocations resulted in a four-year grant of $150,000 a year being cut off to 2 years very suddenly and having to end that project. And then our drug-free communities application was pending. We did not know if it was going to be funded. This board approved for 2014 $125,000 in additional levy to keep that program running in that gap year. The heroin task force had just been formed, and this board agreed that was important work to keep going, and we did ultimately, we were ultimately successful in another five-year, $650,000 grant, so we've been able to continue that work. We also were successful in some additional grant funding for a farm to school program, which took over for that CTG program, and that really, that brought us back to, you know, what our original budget projections were. In late 2014, as we were, and actually some of this information we didn't even get until 2015. So in 2014, we were potentially going to run short. We didn't fill the positions that we really wanted to fill. The last thing I wanted to have happen was to have us have to lay off staff after hiring new staff. You know, we've done a good job of keeping all the staff from the three municipalities together and employed until not having any layoffs, and we certainly didn't want to change that, and so we've been able to repurpose some staff to keep that going. We started a reorganization plan. We really had enough time to start really gelling as a new department and looked at, you know, how we can best provide service, how we can transition our services into the future, working in more of a population-based model. We finished that reorganization in 2015, early 2015, early of this year. We also consolidated the two North End offices, and so now we're still in the process of of moving forward with that reorganization and looking to fill some key positions, and we'll keep working at that. I did want to point out that you know, over the period from consolidation to present, we're nearly exhausted the old health department reserve fund, which was for the towns. We've decreased levy for health department services to the towns by about $1 million over the last 3 years. So those funds have been largely dispersed back to the towns. The last small amount that's left in that reserve will be dispersed back in 2016. And in the years of 2013 and 2014, and what we're projecting into 2015, I shouldn't even say projecting, I just ran a quick calculation on, you know, what those three departments were looking like, you know, back before consolidation in terms of what their levy was, added an estimated 2% annually to what those levy costs were from that time frame to present, from the time of consolidation to present, and between what we've put in reserve in the last 2 years and what we've saved in levy over the last 3 years, that totals over $1.3 million. We will probably have some money's going to reserve this year as well, just because we have some positions that we budgeted for that aren't filled, and that'll increase that number even more. So I really just wanted you to know that, you know, we did project a savings in this process, and that you know, the money that you authorized to have spent to have that study done and the work that was done, you know, has resulted in savings, and it's resulted you know, in you know, a great new department. A couple months ago, I gave you all copies of the of annual report from 2014 that was on your desk. I didn't really reference it that night, but I wanted you to have it so that you could see what the activities were that were going on in the health department. And I'll leave short on that tonight, but just wanted to leave you with a sense of, you know, what's this five-year process been like. Where are we today? And then I'm really looking forward to, you know, with our reorganization and the work that we're starting to do now, for the staff are going to do some amazing things over the next few years. So, thank you. Any questions?
Supervisor Shirk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Doug, compared to when you had two locations in Neenah, and you combined it into one, what impact did that have on staffing?
We had an efficiency of reducing one support staff. We actually are retraining a support staff to work in the Well Woman program right now. So all the staff remain. We've had one resignation for a nurse that went back to school. I think we probably have a retirement coming up in a year or so, maybe, but the staffing largely remains unchanged, and it's only been a couple months.
But public health and WIC are now at the same building.
Correct. So public health and WIC are together. Public health is in the former veteran space at the Neenah Human Services building, and we're able to offer all of the health services in one location. We basically model the services that we're providing currently in Oshkosh, in Neenah, and continue to operate there.
Thank you.
Supervisor Finch.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to tell the group here that about a year ago, there was some rumors, and I called Doug up, and we talked two, three, four different times back and forth. So what I'm trying to say is Doug's a good guy, and if you have a question, don't be afraid to call him and ask him, you know. And he worked very hard to satisfy my needs, because I had to satisfy other people's needs. But I was very impressed with what he's done. And just look at the money he saved just over the past year and a half. So anyway, kudos to you, guy.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, the process of submitting ideas for county board rule changes. Supervisor Wingren.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The Judiciary Committee, as you know, has the
the duty of proposing rule changes. You are aware of the rules of this board, obviously. You have a handbook that lists them. If you wish to submit any ideas for rule changes, the procedure that we're going to use is this. If you have an idea for a rule change, submit the idea on a single piece of paper. If you have two ideas, obviously, two separate pieces of paper. Those need to be received by me by next Monday, the 7th of September. Then we will look at them at our next meeting, the 14th. Finally, on the Judiciary Committee meeting in February of 2016, we will be voting on what rule changes we wish to submit to the full board for their approval or disapproval. And of course, that will take effect with the election of the new board in April of next year. So by Monday, please get any ideas to me. Think about it now before you forget. Get them to me. And also, I think our committee says, think about if. Are you sure that it's a good rule change? We've talked about this a lot, and maybe something isn't as bad as we thought. So give it some careful thought, and we'll give everybody their due consideration. Thank you.
I brought in a bunch one year, different rule changes that I thought. And the gentleman back then told me, be careful what you wish for.
Exactly.
Supervisor Robel.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll move that we adjourn until Tuesday, August 15th at 6 p.m. Our regular business meeting.
Okay, we're adjourned.